Kirsten. I'm a Master of Science candidate of clinical psychology based in Dresden, currently traveling Portugal. So let us all cross fingers that Wi-Fi will be fine. And I'm really glad about everybody who joined this presentation. My goal for today is that all of you will leave with kind of really basic starter toolkit that you might apply immediately after this presentation on how to support somebody who might be currently struggling or experiencing mental health issues. So you kind of could consider this a very shortened version of the Mental Health Allyship Program I co-founded with the most basic and best practice insights that we have collected over the past 1.5 years. So thanks to Sarah, you're all having quite a little idea about the Mental Health Allyship Program. Just a few words from my side. So it's a very low threshold online training, trying to involve basically everybody to take care of the people around him and to enable people to provide proper support to the people around them. So it's a very compact format. So it lasts 5 hours. It's a volunteer based, so we can guarantee that the access is free, and also to the online format, especially during COVID, accessible from all over the world, basically. And we furthermore follow a peer-to-peer approach. That means we are not only giving input to the participants, but we are also all learning together from each other's experiences and expertise. All of the team has either way a psychological or a medicine background, or is either way personally experienced with mental health issues, him or herself, or as an affiliated person. But we also welcome everybody who just wants to join the team and is just interested in supporting our mission as well. What is our mission? So we want to make basic knowledge and skills on how to support one another accessible to everyone. So this program and also kind of today's presentation follows this mission, because we believe until there is no general and mandatory education on how to support one another, for example, in schools or connected to the driving license, we just have to provide the general public with a few basic action plans and with basic knowledge to be enabled to take action. And so in the next 45 minutes, I'm trying to kind of prepare you guys a little more today. So for you to get the most out of today's presentation, I just want you to take a few seconds for yourself to think of a personal situation that you're maybe in that probably motivated you to join today's presentation. So maybe a situation where you're wondering if somebody else around you might be struggling, or you know that this person is having a mental health issue, but you aren't just not so sure how to provide proper support. And I want you to keep that in mind during the following presentation, and I'd love you to try to connect the information I'm giving you directly to the specific situation to ease a little bit of transfer from this very compact impulse presentation I'm giving to you today. If nothing comes up to your mind, no worries, it's not necessary, but it might help you a little more to use the knowledge I'm giving you today in your everyday life. So let's get right into it. Today's timeline is following the title, the ABC of helping others in need. So we will talk about attention, bonding, and challenges. So we want to figure out what's in store when we pay attention to the mental health of others, what impact we can have, and also what warning signals might indicate that somebody is currently struggling. Secondly, in the bonding block, we want to talk about how we can make a connection, how we can get into a conversation and support someone in the short as well as in the long term. And last but not least, I'd like to try to prepare you a little for some common challenges you might be facing when getting into contact with someone and trying to support someone. So let's start with attention. Before we are diving right into it, I'd like to motivate you even a little more to take care of the well-being of other people and give you some background information, very basic, about the development of mental illness, which is the vulnerability stress model, So the very basic idea is that every person can develop a mental illness. The risk is just different from person to person. It's because everybody has experienced stressful life events, maybe even traumatic life events, and those stress is summing up across the lifespan. And if you develop a mental illness or not depends on what kind of vulnerability you're having. So if your vulnerability is really high, less stressful life events are going to cause the barrel to overflow and you to develop a mental illness. So this vulnerability is, of course, different from person to person, but also differs across the lifespan. The good news is that you're not a victim of your vulnerability. So you, all of you, are having personal resources that help you to manage stressful life events. So this can be some genetic factors, also how you behave, if you see if the glass is always full, or I don't know how the saying goes, like if you have a positive outlook on things or not. All of these things can take a few of the stressful events off and prevent the barrel from overflowing. The other good news is that we as a social support system can do this as well. So social support is a resource for others and might prevent them from developing a mental illness because we can support them to manage stressful life events in a very healthy way and to prevent the barrel from overflowing. A third good news is that we are not only able to support one another and to prevent mental illness from occurring, we can also support people when the barrel already overflowed and a mental illness already occurred. Why is this important? From a representative study in Germany, we know that only about 1 in 5 people with mental illness receives treatment within 1 year. So that means only 1 in 5 people who is actually in need of professional support doesn't receive one. This might be, of course, due, I think we're all aware of that, due to the waiting list problem with psychotherapy, but a huge impact also has the behavior of the affected persons themselves, because many people don't even get in touch to professional support services. The reason for that are, quite varied and diverse. Here is just an overview of a few we can name. So usually they're associated fears and worry what might happen after a diagnosis. It's also very hard to understand when you're really suffering and when do you really need help. And a huge factor is a stigma in that sense, because your self-stigmatizing attitudes like, oh, I don't deserve the treatment, there are people who have it way worse, etc., keep you from looking out for help, but also the stigma of others, maybe your boss, who doesn't seem like the kind of guy who'd like to have a depressed worker in his company, etc. So those things keep people from looking out for help. Also, many symptoms of mental illness and psychological disorders make it even harder to look out for help. Plus the lack of knowledge around where can I get help, what is the appropriate help for me, are often unknown and even overwhelming for people who are mentally stable, but even more overwhelming for people currently struggling. And this whole process, as well as therapy or counseling itself, can be, or most of the time is, exhausting and is a lot of work. So all those factors prevent people from looking out for help. And they form the so-called treatment gap that people don't get in contact with support service. And we as a social support system can influence this process with providing knowledge, with motivating people to look out for help, with being supportive and not judging and not stigmatizing them. So that not maybe 1 in 5 people, but maybe 3, 4, or in best case, 5 out of 5 people get into contact for the appropriate professional health system. So now that we know why it's so important to support other people and to involve oneself into the mental health of others, we have to know how can we do that. So how can we do that? We first have to know and we first have to understand the signs that someone might be in need of help or might be struggling. So we organized 6 categories of typical warning signs of mental distress. And I personally don't like to assign them to psychological disorders. I think it's, of course, helpful background knowledge, but I don't think that all of you need this. Because from a very basic point of view, you just have to know that someone is struggling. You don't have to be able to make the diagnosis. But of course, it won't, it's not a bad thing, so it's helpful as well. So following 6 categories of common warning signs of mental distress. Here's the overview. So the first one is change in mood. So you people might be suddenly easily irritable, lethargic, or even joyful or euphoric. Secondly, it's change in perception. You might notice that when people are expressing things like, ah, everything goes wrong recently, nothing is fun anymore, etc. Thirdly, change in behavior. So some people might withdraw from their social activities or their social circle. Some people might suddenly get more aggressive, get more into drinking alcohol, start to self-injure, etc. So you see the span of possible behavior changes is quite wide. Fourth category is physical changes. This is a tricky one because they of course might also stem from physical illnesses, and many people don't consider that these symptoms might also stem from a psychological point of view. So you might see a change in sleep, in appetite, weight loss or gain, headache, or basically pain everywhere in the body. Or also a change in body hygiene. The fifth category covers acute and specific signals. So this might be panic attacks, mostly associated with anxiety disorders, or hallucinations associated with, for example, schizophrenia. So this category kind of covers the association with concrete psychological disorders. And the sixth category is the expression of suffering and dissatisfaction. And you probably know it from yourself. This is also a very personal one. So some people might be openly crying or complaining to you about their suffering or their limitations. And some people just might withdraw and not express it at all. So the diversity of the examples is just a gentle reminder that everybody is expressing suffering and mental distress differently. But what you can take from this list is that there are two very important factors. One is you see a change in mood, perception, behavior, physique, etc., from when people felt well and healthy to when people are struggling and feel stressed. And a second factor is suffering. So people kind of have to experience associated suffering and limitations in their personal, social, or professional life. And this change in suffering doesn't or needs to occur for a longer time span. So it's not just after a breakup or your job loss, you experience some of those warning signs for 3 days. That's perfectly normal and fine. But if this happens for a few weeks or months, we as a social support system should be aware and get into contact to ask what's going on. So this leads us to the end of block A, attention, and to the first take home message, which might sound a little uncommon, because I want to remind you that you trust your gut, because I feel like most of us have a very natural ability to sense what people are feeling. So of course you have to be attentive to the people around you, but when we are and we care about the people around us, we usually sense that something is off. We just can't put our finger on it. And this list of warning signs is there to help you navigate a little better and to point out what's happening. But in the end, it's your gut that's telling you that something is off, and that this is, in most cases, it's enough. So you should trust yourself that you know when something is off. This leads us to the part B, bonding. So after we now know what we have to look out for when we want to understand or guess if someone is struggling, we now want to find out how can we express our worries and get into contact with people in a, of course, respectful and of course also self-confident manner. So for this reason, we developed a guide for supportive conversation, which is called the 5A. And this guide is supposed to give you a little orientation, a little structure, and more self-confidence to know what you're doing during this conversation. In our original program, we practiced this a lot. We don't have time for that today, but I hope this might motivate you a little to maybe use this in your personal example you've been thinking about at the beginning, or just to screenshot it and use it later when you're confronted with a situation where you're not feeling too self-confident. So the 5A conversation guide consists of attention, which we talked about already, approach with offer for conversation, acceptance, authenticity, and advice and options. For me now, I just want to add some in-depth information about this conversation guide that helps you to understand what the single points indicate and how you can apply this in your everyday life. So the first A, attention, after covering this in the first block, all that's left for me to say is that you don't only have to pay attention to the people around us, but of course also to your own health and your own well-being. So you cannot support someone properly if you're struggling yourself. So this is actually the first step to know how to guess how you are feeling, and then to look out for other people. So the second A is the most important one, but also the most difficult one for most people, because we are getting into a quite uncomfortable because unusual situation and feel like we're invading personal space. But it's so important to open this door to talk about this topic, because no matter how this conversation goes, the other person knows that somebody's interested and someone is available to talk about this. To give you three tips how to navigate this, choose a safe place at first. Safe that you feel safe, but as well to provide or to give the person the feeling that this is a safe place to talk about us and not in the middle of something. To communicate your worries, we suggest to use I messages. For example, I notice that, I perceive that, I am worried about this, and to combine this with the concrete observations you can take from the first step, attention, so that the counterpart knows where you're coming from, why you're in this conversation, and doesn't feel too overwhelmed. And if you're interested in further information, just as in any other case, use open-ended we questions, such as why is that, what happened, where does this come from, who did this, etc. Second tip, if the person wants to have a conversation, great. Then listen actively, be patient, take breaks so the person feels safe and like he or she or them has room to express their concerns. If you receive a rejection, that's fine as well. Then just reassure that your offer is open-ended and follow up, or let the counterpart get in contact again. The third A is acceptance. So this is kind of a mindset thing. That should help you during the whole conversation to just get into with a very neutral and accepting mindset. So try not to judge, try to accept whatever the other person is telling you, and show that you both can bear it together and that you're not trying to change anything immediately and put solutions into the conversation and so on. And also very important, try to see the counterpart as a whole person and not only as the current burden or illness that the person might be experiencing. The fourth A, I really like this a lot, because this is a reminder of your very natural and unique ability to support someone. Because usually when we're getting into a conversation, we kind of slip into pretending that we are like the helper and the other person is in need of help. We are trying to be little psychologists I do this myself as well. And it's not helpful because what is so unique about a social environment is that we can do things a psychologist never could do. Like we could give a hug, we could go for a walk and talk about it. We're having this emotional bond in such different ways. So we don't need to have solutions. We don't have to play a role. We can just be ourselves and also be authentic with our emotions, comments, questions, and so on. So this is to lift a little pressure off of your chest and to just go into the situation as the person that you are. Yes, the last A is advice and options. And this covers a lot of different things because everybody needs something different. Different things are available. Different things are like personal preferences and so on. So my first advice is that you just ask the counterpart what is needed. So most of the times they already know their resources, some strategies or confidence that you both can involve. If not, just try to talk about it if you feel comfortable. Give advice. You can also, of course, point out external offers of help if you feel like this is required. And if desired, provide support in establishing contact. So this can be really helpful to just call somebody together or to just to go together to the psychologist to ease this professional contact. So those are the 5A, while the first 4A are usually a thing you just have to groove in with, so you just have to use it and practice it to feel comfortable with it. The advice on options is the A where most of the people felt like they needed a little more input. So this is what I'm also trying to do with you as well, because unfortunately there is no central information center, and it's basically a quite overwhelming jungle to get which support service is appropriate, what do I need, or what does the other person need. So this is a little three-step overview for you, and you can decide for yourself or pick with the person what is needed. We just suggest that with increasing duration and severity of the burden, you just use one of the of step two of three offers to provide help. And also very personal advice, if in doubt, just contact anybody, because they are all professionals in some kind of way, and they are going to happily help you to find the appropriate support. So use them as a team player as well when you're trying to provide support. So the first step is like the most low threshold option, is when people want to talk anonymously about their struggles. So there are numerous telephone helplines, or even chat options online in German and also available in English. The second one is if someone wants to get more into detail and maybe wants to try out some face-to-face intervention, there are social psychiatric services in almost every city or at least every region, as well as psychosocial counseling services in every city or region, and even universities, companies, institutes, etc. There, some of them also provide psychosocial counseling. And I like this a lot because they don't do therapy in this quite extended sense, but they cover up to 5 counseling sessions. And in some situations, this is enough to deal with some smaller problems. And they also support you in establishing contact to a more professional or psychotherapy options. And this is a very important reminder. Sometimes you just have to be aware that a diagnosis or even psychotherapy might be associated with some disadvantages for your private insurance, your occupational disability insurance, or your civil servant status as for teachers, police officers, and so on. So you just have to be aware of those consequences and maybe try out step two services first. And if this is not enough, you can forward to a psychotherapist as well. The last one I already spoiled quite often is wait and do therapy. So we know about the waiting list, but in many cases, this should not stop you from doing psychotherapy, because it works, and it works best the earlier you get into contact. And due to COVID, there's a rise in online therapy offers. I added two websites for you. They are also available in English, and they also provide a psychotherapist search in your mother tongue. So this might be helpful for you. So after this three-step scheme, I guess you're not feeling much more educated on the support system, because it's quite a lot, but it can give you a little orientation. And the next step will be to use Google. So Google is your friend. So whatever service you're looking for, just put it into Google at your city and maybe the mother tongue you're looking for. And you unfortunately really have to do your own research. I also suggest to ask for recommendation in your friend circle or friends who might study psychology and so on. They might support you during that. So now that you're familiar with our conversation guide, I hope you're feeling a little more self-confident in approaching someone with a mental health issue. And I'd like to give you a little outlook what you can do in the long term, because of course the conversation guide is valid for every conversation you are going into, but many of our participants were wondering if there are special things you can do if someone very close to you in your family or your best friend is struggling. So how can you be in help in the long term, of help in the long term? And that's why we asked 45 people with a mental illness what their affiliated did well or what helps them best. And those are six categories of the most common answers that I'd like to share with you. And you can see they are quite understandable interests and understandable needs that probably everybody of us is having. So they want people to be interested, to inquire repeatedly, to just have open conversations and listen, to show understanding and take the person seriously, to be there, but also to be okay to give space when this is needed. I like the fifth point, which are concrete offers or activities, such as phone calls, visits, going for a walk, so it doesn't have to evolve around the topic mental health issues all the time. You can also have just a very nice social relationship. And the last one is also quite interesting, that this corresponds to your power as a affiliated person. You can also be a reminder. So you can be a reminder that there are support services. You can be a reminder of the things the person learned during counseling or therapy, and so on. And I'm showing you this if you try to kind of assign this to the 5A concept, this works in some way, but mostly I wanted to show you there are very different things that people need, but they are usually very understandable, and probably all of us have experienced one, two, or all of these needs ourselves. And if you're struggling what the other person might need, I just want to motivate you to ask this person what he, she, or them needs. In most of the cases, they know best, and this might give you a little security. The take-home message for this, the bonding block is, it's better to ask too much than too little. So I'm totally aware that this whole process feels overwhelming because it's so uncomfortable and uncommon to us. But if you made the first step to reach out and to open a conversation, it doesn't matter how this conversation goes, if it's successful to you or the other person or not, just ask and be brave and get into contact. This leads us to the last block, to challenges, because now we know what to look out for. We have some sort of idea what strategies might help us to support someone in the short and in the long term. And the last block is about challenges, because let's be real, we are going to face challenges, because this is always going to happen when we're talking about such a personal topic, how someone is really feeling. And I'm giving you a little, some sort of advices that I hope are going to help you to feel more self-confident with this. I chose, out of all the challenges you might be facing, three. First one is suicidality, so the option that people consider taking their life, have suicidal thoughts or plans. The second one is rejection. And the last one is the phenomenon that helping hurts you as a source of support as well. We're going to start with suicidality, and I want to give you just a little trigger warning that I'm going to talk about this topic for the next 5 minutes. And if you're feeling, if you know that you might feel triggered by this, just do what's good for you. And you can, of course, also step out of this presentation. But after 5 minutes, we will continue with another topic. So, suicidality. That might happen during a conversation that someone expresses something, you're not really sure what is she trying to say. Does that indicate something? And there are many myths around the topic suicidality. And I'd like to bust a lot of them today, but I want to address the most common and also the most unfortunate one, which is asking if someone is suicidal might put the idea in their head. To put it short, this is just not true. This is a myth. The fact is that asking if someone is suicidal saves life or might save a life. Taking from one study, they found that if you're inquiring, people with past suicidal attempts even lowers the number of suicides. So there's a lot of research in this field as well. So this is a reminder that one of our biggest concern mindset that might keep us from talking about this topic is simply a myth and not true. And I want to motivate you to talk openly about it. Since most of us are going to be lost for words in such a situation, I just want to suggest a very concrete formulation, which is, have you thought about taking your life lately? Of course, you can use your own words as well. I just want to remind you that you have to be as direct and concrete as possible, because otherwise people might try to get, the other person might try to get his, her, or their way around it, doesn't want to bother you, etc. So be as concrete, because then you also feel more secure with the answer and to kind of guess if the person is telling the truth or not, if you've been as concrete and direct as possible. If you still aren't really sure, try to communicate your doubts and discuss it with the person. You might also involve someone together, some closer family member or friend. And in any case, if you're feeling like the person is going to do damage to him, her, or themselves, you are allowed and also asked to call 110 or 112. There are actually a lot of more things to say about it, but I just want to remind you that if you're in doubt and you couldn't solve it with a lot of communication, then call 110 or 112. They are going to provide proper support. There are many more things to be said. You don't have to worry about the fact that you're now going to have to ask everybody if they're feeling suicidal to be completely sure, because there are a bunch of typical warning signs of suicidality. Maybe you could call them red flags that should make you consider the option of a person being suicidal. Those warning signs, I'd like to start with a few risk populations. So you should be especially attentive with people who are acutely mentally stressed or in a crisis, people with a mental disorder, especially depression. So most of suicides are committed by people with depressive symptoms or depressive disorders. But also be attentive with people with people with severe physical illness, like chronic diseases, people with substance abuse, elderly, lonely, isolated people, also past suicide attempts, they're a risk factor for suicide as well, suicides in the social environment, and as well male gender. So many people are confused about the male gender. Well, this is because partly because this still existing classic role model of the strong man makes it really difficult to talk about this topic and to get an honest response to questions of suicidality. So there are more suicides committed by men than women. And here are a few red flag expressions. You will see they are usually quite unconcrete, like, oh, I can't do it anymore. Nothing of this makes sense anymore. I wish it was all over. So usually people don't, aren't very concrete and specific. So this is why you should be concrete and specific when asking about this. Another red flag and a quite surprising warning sign could be a sudden improvement in depressive symptoms for no apparent reason. So maybe people with depression for a long, long time show a sudden improvement and everybody's happy that they are feeling better, but this could also be due to a relief they are experiencing because they made a plan and scheduled their suicide. So this is a red flag you should be considering. And also behavior that indicates parting, such as people visiting their whole family and close friends in their home country. They're giving away valuables. They are inquiring about their life insurance, etc. So yeah, keep those warning signs in mind, screenshot it or write it down. They are really important and they should motivate you to ask about the possibility of suicidality. Yeah, this is all for today. I want to try to cover the past two challenges as well. The second challenge you might be, or yeah, let's be honest, you're going to be confronted with is rejection. Rejection is very typical for certain disorders such as eating disorders, substance use disordered, mania or manic episodes, and also psychotic illnesses such as schizophrenia. It's also very typical in men because of this classical gender role model in general. Yeah. But it's also typical for men, women, no matter the age, no matter the experiences, because we are talking about a very sensitive person, a topic, and it's just normal that not everybody is ready to get to talk about this. What can you do? Fortunately, out of the five A's, we have the third A, acceptance. We can apply here. Acceptance also means that we're accepting that the other person has a different opinion or perception on the current situation and that no change happens over time. So be patient, give the counterpart time. If you're really sure that something is off and you want to motivate the counterpart, you can try to do that by gently drawing attention to the physical, social, or professional limitations, such as, oh, you haven't been sleeping for a few weeks, don't you want to sleep again? You've been training so much for your football career and now you can't do this anymore, don't you want to get back to this? You've looked so sad lately, you know that it doesn't have to be like this, that don't you want to do something about it, etc. And the second tip for you is just take the pressure off. So you don't have to reach anything, or you don't have to reach a certain goal. Just be prepared for the headwind and be fine, however this conversation might be going. So sorry, I just had to check the chat. Try to apply those two advices, but in general, you should not work more than the other person, because, and this is bringing us to the last challenge, helping can also hurt. So this is usually happening if you're supporting someone in the long term and you know notice that your own mental health is suffering. And first, I have to say congratulations that you notice a change in your mental health and that you're attentive with yourself there. But usually when people have been helping someone, this feeling of, there's a feeling of guilt and shame when you yourself are struggling. And that's why I want to shortly introduce the phenomenon of co-rumination, which you might notice or have experienced yourself. This is when people are just discussing and chewing over problems again and again, and you don't find a solution, you don't make any progress, and it does no good for you as a supporter, but also not to the affected person, because you are stuck in this dynamic and you don't find any solution and also don't give any motivation to change something about this. So I don't want to go through all those warning signals. Maybe you can screenshot this. But if you experience some sort of unbalanced dynamic, you feel like you are consumed by the other person's problems, that you are not eye to eye with your friend or a family member anymore, then this is a red flag for co-rumination. And this should motivate you to step back and take time for yourself and your own mental health. I can see the time's running up. There are a few tips how you can step back. Actually, those are all things I just talked about during the presentation. So you can forward someone to support service. You can include somebody else to take off the whole responsibility of your shoulders and have to communicate it. And you can reach out to people close to you or professional support services as well. And this brings us to the end of the last block. And the take home message for this is helping is an offer. So that means that the counterpart always has the right to decline your offer of helping, but you have this as well. So you can always step back when you're not feeling well and prioritize your own mental health and your own well-being. So this is the end of the presentation. If you feel like this ABC of helping others is not enough, or you're not feeling really confident right now, I completely agree with you, because every situation is different. Every person is different. It's almost impossible to be completely prepared for every situation. But I still have four more advices for you. If you want to get more involved into this topic and if you're feeling insecure in the future, apart from the impulses I gave you today, I can only recommend to ask for advice. So please team up with the people around you or the people around the affected person, and also team up with support services. That's what they are there for. You can also continue to educate yourself through training such as our mental health allyship program. I will post the link in shortly. Or also the training of the mental health first aid that they're also doing a presentation during this week as well. Podcasts, books, whatever suits you best. Talk openly about your own mental health and distress and illness, and also reach out to people and break the taboo, because stigmatization is one of the major factors that is preventing people from reaching out to help. And with every word you speak about this, you're breaking down the taboo. And the last one is have a little faith in yourself, that if you're trying your best and if you're sincerely caring about the people around you, things will be okay, no matter if you feel prepared or as self-confident as you would like to feel. So thank you. This is the end of the presentation. Thank you for joining. Thank you for caring about others. And I appreciate everyone of you for joining me today.